Hey professionals, when I was 19, I started struggling with anxiety and I mastered it to the extent that I became high functioning, but I still struggled with anxiety for 20 years. In this video, I'm going to tell you that story, and in telling it to you, I'm going to tell you about 7 really powerful lessons that I learned from that experience. And more importantly, the transformational thing that I wished I'd learned earlier. My name's Steve, and I coach professional people just like you to create a happier and more successful experience of your life and work. And a good place to start is with my simple, free, 5-step process for mastering stress in the moment. So picture this. I was 19. It was my second year at university. And up to that point, I had been, yes, a serious-minded individual, but also a free-spirited individual. What I mean by that is that, yes, I worked hard, I took my work and results seriously, but I lived in the world like a free-spirited soul, like I didn't have any serious responsibilities. Now, although I'd been working hard and had done pretty well up to this point, it's fair to say that I'd developed the habit of doing things late rather than early, and I was getting a little bit complacent. And one night, quite unexpectedly, round about 3 o'clock in the morning, I woke up in a massive panic about my upcoming exams. It's like I'd suddenly realised how close they were getting, and I felt ill-prepared. It suddenly looked like there was a mountain I had to climb, and I felt overwhelmed. So with a massive sense of urgency, I lurched at getting back in front. I drank too much caffeine, I had too much sugar, and I burned too much midnight oil. And I crashed. Physically and emotionally, I crashed. My personality felt suddenly bent out of shape, as if a sheet metal over the edge of a table got whacked with a hammer. And as I came out of that crash, I had about a year or two of suffering really quite bad depression and anxiety. Now, I got through those exams, and I actually did pretty well, but I shredded myself doing it. And when I came through the other side of that, I made a decision. I decided I was never, ever gonna let that happen again. So having averted what seemed to me like a near-miss catastrophe, I decided that for my third year at university, I was gonna get in front and I was gonna be super organized. I decided that I was gonna read ahead of the lectures rather than read behind them, so that I was going into the lectures with a pretty good grounding of what we were going to learn, and the lecture itself would close the gaps rather than be fresh learning that would have gaps. And I decided that if there were going to be assignments, I would do those assignments as early as possible, not as late as possible. So I'd go into my lectures having pre-read the material, and when there was assignment, I'd pretty much go straight away to the library to do that assignment while it was still fresh. Now, that habit had tremendous results for me. I experienced my third year at university as the easiest year I'd ever had in education, even though it was meant to be the hardest. And I got tremendous results in my final exams. Now, here's the thing. None of that was because I was especially clever. In actual fact, I am not especially clever. I'm actually quite slow on the uptake a lot of the time. It's because I got organized and I got proactive. That's all it was. It was getting disciplined and doing things sooner rather than later. So that was the first thing that I learned, that a great way to overcome overwhelm is to get in front of your work. In a way, this is where the anxiety, I guess, kind of served me. Now, don't get me wrong. It's not that I was happy to have anxiety. I would much sooner have discovered this without having it. But it did thrust me with a sense of urgency, with a need to change those habits. Now, that habit which I learned through that third year at university still serves me today. And I've enjoyed a lot of professional success as a consequence of it. But here's the thing, it didn't actually deal with the anxiety. So if the first lesson was to get in front of the workload, lesson number 2 was that that actually doesn't make the anxiety go away. I hoped it might, but in the same way that stockpiling money doesn't actually make you more secure around money, getting in front of your work doesn't actually make you feel more secure about life. Now, I would get anxious about all kinds of things. What if people don't like me? What if my work isn't really good enough? What if there are sea changes happening in my industry that I'm not staying in front of? And despite doing well, I was on edge pretty much most of the time for the next calamity that would be creeping up on me from my blind spot. Now, in time and with no particular work other than patience, the frequency and intensity of those anxious feelings did diminish. But if I veered too close to what looked to me like another possible close call calamity, I could get yanked right back into it. Now, to other people, they would see things I would get anxious about, and they would know that actually that's not worth sweating over. So, lesson three, what you get anxious about isn't necessarily rational. It's not worth getting anxious about. And if you can build good relationships with people who can spot you doing that, point it out to you and pull you back, do so. I found it useful and I know you can do it. And related to that is my fourth lesson, which is that time helps, but it is slow and you can get yanked back very easily. Now, my 20s came to an end and I had a suboptimal experience of those years because of this anxiety. They could have been the best years of my life and my 30s were disappearing too. By the way, if you're enjoying this video so far, do give it the thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe to the channel and click the notifications bell so that you'll get notified when new content arrives. I didn't always show that I could get anxious. A lot of people wouldn't have known. As the years go on, you learn to live with it, you get on with it. You don't always show it, even though it's an unpleasant experience. And it's also partly because I learned, this is lesson number five, by the way, that you can develop things that you are good at and you are confident at doing them, even though you get anxiety. I became a really confident IT professional and I knew my territory. I also became a really confident public speaker, which is kind of funny because public speaking is something that most people do get anxious about. I was good at it and I loved it, but I was the one labelled as anxious. Well, I was anxious, just about other things. Now, I mentioned that my 20s disappeared and my 30s were disappearing, and I hadn't achieved the inner peace and the deep down happiness that I really wanted. Part of me even feared that if I did, I would lose that drive and that motivation that made me so good at some things. People recommended things to me, NLP, meditation, spiritual practices. Now, at first I rejected all that because I thought this fluffy mind stuff probably wouldn't work. But also I started to think that maybe I actually needed my anxiety. And that's the sixth thing I learned from this experience, that you can develop a sort of Stockholm syndrome with your anxiety and make fear-based excuses for not doing anything about it. Now, I'm fortunate. I won't say lucky because I don't think it was luck, but I started to see that it was possible to live and work from a deeper and more peaceful ground of being, and I started to connect with people who could show me that. I started doing work with my coaches and my teachers. Now, lots of people out there promise quick fixes and silver bullets, and there are plenty of rapid change techniques out there, but for change at the deep level that I was looking for, it did take some time. But with work, and by the way, although I use the word work, I'm not sure it's the right word because it wasn't really effortful, but it did require some consistency. And it involved things like peaceful meditations, deep inquiries, mind work, and opening up to new emotional experiences. And the cumulative effect of that work was that I became more peaceful. I can't really pinpoint a moment where it happened, but I started to realize that I was there. And I continued to deepen that work. Now, I'm not going to say that I'm perfect, and I don't think perfection is even a thing with this work. But certainly from where I started, if it was here, I moved a long way. And that's the seventh thing I learned in this experience, that it might not be instant results, but with work, you can develop a deeper and more peaceful ground of being to live and work from. And what I discovered is that when you do that, when you live and work from a deeper and more peaceful ground of being, not only do you feel healthier in your mind and in your emotions, but it actually improves your results. It increases your impact and influence in the world because you get this sense of clear mind, clear thought, clear intention, and that space for clear action. Action coming from groundedness and clarity rather than fear, ego, and insecurity. Now, I don't believe in regrets because that's like carrying around old baggage that weighs you down. However, if I could have given my 19-year-old self a piece of advice, it would have been to start with this work much sooner. Now, if you'd be interested in talking with me about this, I would love to hear from you. But also, watch this video up here about when we can't stop thinking about work. Or if you've already watched that video, then watch this video down here instead. This is Steve, wishing you health and happiness.